Our students of dentistry for the class, I am greet you, and in the University of Babylon, you are welcome. We are go back to talk about another important topics in orthodontics, which is the diagnostic records. Our students, the clinical success of orthodontic patients having certain type of malocclusion is difficult to be achieved by using the history taking or the case sheet, as well as the clinical examination of the patients. In other words, the informations that are collected from the patient during the history taking as well as the clinical examination are not enough to the degree that the diagnosis of the patient is difficult unless by using the diagnostic records or the orthodontic clinical records. So the diagnostic records are the key points for the success of the treatment planning as well as the orthodontic treatment of the patients. Such diagnostic records are very important for the diagnosis of the patient as well as the treatment planning of the patient, in addition to in the monitoring of the growth and development of the patient. Also, it can be considered as a connection between the orthodontist or between the orthodontist and the patient him or herself. The first type of these diagnostic records or the clinical orthodontic records is the study models. Sometimes it is difficult to assess or inspect certain aspects of malocclusion during the articulation or by depending on the clinical examination alone. So the study models can be used to assess the lingual as well as the facial aspects of the teeth during their articulation. Also, the study model can be used for band selection, so we can save a time as well as to overcome the orthodontic band contamination. Also, study models can be used for space analysis as well as a pre-treatment records. The second type of these clinical orthodontic records that are essential for collection of information about the orthodontic patients to reach the perfect diagnosis are the clinical photographs. These photographs in general are divided into either extraoral photographs as well as intraoral photographs. The extraoral photographs having different views. These are the lateral or the facial profile, the other it is called the facial three-quarter, in addition to the frontal view of the face with and without a smile. These are the common features or the common types of extraoral view of the face. Likewise, the intraoral photographs also are subdivided into different views. These are the occlusal view of the upper as well as the lower arch. Also, the buccal occlusion from the left and from the right, and not forgetting the labial or the frontal occlusion. These are the common photographic views during taking the intraoral photographs. The other type of these orthodontic records are the radiographs. The common types of these radiographs that are of special interest in orthodontic diagnosis and treatment planning are the following. First, the occlusal film radiograph. Such radiographic view is very important to predict whether there is a pathology or a periapical lesion within the arch, either the maxilla or the mandible. Also, in cases when there is a cleft palate patients. In addition, in cases of impaction. As you see here, there is a bilateral maxillary canine impaction. So we can assess by using such a view the nature of impaction as well as the progress or the improvement in treatment when a force is applied on the tooth. The other type of these radiographs is the posterior-anterior radiograph. Such radiographic view is very important to study the horizontal relation of the facial bones and the jaw, either within the jaw itself or between the upper and the lower jaw in transverse direction. So we can assess whether there is a skeletal or dental crossbite, in addition, the symmetry of the face. The other type of these radiographs is the lateral cephalometric radiograph. Such a view is a specialized view of the facial skeleton as well as the cranial base from the lateral aspect. So it is called lateral cephalometric radiograph, which have different uses. The other type of these views is the orthopantomograph or the OPG. In such a view, we can assess whether there is a root resorption. In some cases, during the orthodontic treatment, as well as when there's a supernumerary tooth or impacted tooth, in addition to the other uses for the OPG. So, in general, these are the most common types of radiographs that are used during the orthodontic treatment planning. So, we will talk about the lateral cephalometric radiograph. In general, cephalo, it means head, while metric meaning measurements. So the lateral cephalometric radiograph means the metric evaluation of the head from the lateral aspect, or the metric evaluation of the lateral head radiograph. Commonly, such radiographic view is used to assess the various components of the face and relate them to the cranium to see whether or not there is a harmony or balance between them, and to predict that such relation is true, or to exclude the bias in jaw relation. As example, it is recommended to have a standardization, which can be achieved by using a cephalostat, which is one of the most important component of the lateral cephalogram device. Such component having a nasal rod as well as two ear rods that are important to hold the head of the patient in a predetermined position, and any angulation or magnification, it can be controlled by a fixed relationship of the cephalostat with the other components of the device. So the radiograph produced in such a way is standardized, so it is easier to compare the radiograph of the same patients taking in different times, as well as of those taking for different individuals. There are different indications for the lateral cephalometric radiograph. First, diagnosis. In certain cases of malocclusion, it is difficult to ascertain that such type of malocclusion is a skeletal or dental, and whether the maxilla or mandible or both are the contributory factor for such type of malocclusion, unless by taking lateral cephalometric radiograph. The other indication as a pre-treatment record or a baseline record before the orthodontic treatment, especially in cases when there is a treatment planning for the movement of the incisors. The other indication for research purposes, especially in case of growth and developmental studies. The other indication for treatment progress, as example, when there is an impacted tooth or an erupted tooth. So we will monitor the progress or the movement of these teeth during the treatment. So before point identification on the cephalometric radiograph, such radiograph should be subjected to cephalometric tracing. There are two types of tracing, either manual tracing by tracing of the teeth and the facial skeleton, as well as the base of the skull on a tracing paper. So it is called manual tracing. The other type is called computerized tracing or automatic tracing. By such a type of the tracing, we will overcome the common disadvantages of manual tracing, as well as there is no need for manual measurement of the cephalometric values, as these values are displayed on the computer within a few minutes or within a short period of time. So such type of tracing is faster and accurate, but it is more expensive. After cephalometric tracing, certain points or landmarks need to be located on the lateral cephalometric radiograph. These points, in the order of their occurrence, are the following. First is the Nijin point, Silla point, Porion point, Condylian point, orbital point, articular point, anterior nasal spine, posterior nasal spine points, subnasal point, supramental point, pogonian point, mentan point, and the gonian points. When these points are connected, certain reference lines or cephalometric angles will be produced. The commonly used reference lines are the following. First is the anterior cranial base that connect between the Nagian point and the Sella point. The second point, or the second line, is the line that connect between the orbital point and the Porian point, that can be considered as the horizontal line of the head or the Frankfurt line. The third line is the maxillary line that connect between the anterior nasal spine and the posterior nasal spine. The fourth line is the mandibular plane or the mandibular reference line that connect between the mentan point and the gonian points. The clinical significance of these lines can be considered as a stable reference lines to assess the dental as well as the skeletal relation of the jaw. Also, when these lines are continued backward, so certain angles will be produced with each other. So these angles can be used to assess the vertical relation of the face. When these angles are increased, the patient associate with increase in vertical dimension or associate with open bites. Reversely, when these angles are reduced, so commonly the patient can be associated with deep bite or there is a reduction within the vertical dimension. Likewise, beside these cephalometric reference lines, there are certain reference cephalometric angles that are used to assess the sagittal skeletal relationship of the jaw, either with each other or with the anterior cranial base, as well as the dental relation with the jaw bases. So, as example of these angles are the following. First is the SNA angle. Such angle is used to assess the sagittal skeletal relationship of the maxilla with the anterior cranial base, and their normal value is about 81 degree, which can be increased in cases of class 2 malocclusion due to maxillary protrusion. The second angle is the SNB angle, which can be used to assess the skeletal relationship of the mandible with the anterior cranial base in sagittal plane, and their normal value is about 78 degrees. Such angle, it can be increased in case of class 3 malocclusion due to mandibular protrusion. Both of these angles, when they are intersected, so they are forming the ANB angle. Such angle, their normal value is between 2 to 4 degrees in cases of class 1 normal occlusion, which can be increased or reduced in cases of class 2 or class 3 malocclusion respectively. The another type of angles that are used to assess the dental relation with the jaw bases are the following. First, the upper incisors maxillary plane angle, the lower incisors mandibular plane angle, and the inter-incisor angle. All of these three angles can be considered as the angles of stability of the incisors in their normal position after treatment with fixed orthodontic appliance, or the angles that represent or they can predict the labiolingual inclination of the teeth in relation with their jaw bases. However, the projection errors and the landmarks identification and their superimposition, as well as the two-dimensional image of a three-dimensional structure, these are the common disadvantages of these radiographs. So, to overcome these drawbacks, nowadays there will be shifting to a three-dimensional image, which can be provided by the using cone beam computed tomography, or CBCT. As you see here in this slide, you can see that the maxillary canine is impacted. So by using CBCT view, there will be accurate localization of the impacted tooth and later on there will be perfect treatments. So CBCT can be considered as a valuable tool in orthodontic diagnosis and treatment planning. Dear our students, we can conclude it from this video that the orthodontic records can be divided into study models, intraoral and extraoral photographs, and radiographs. These radiographs, although can be considered as a good tool in orthodontic diagnosis and treatment planning, but they are fail in certain cases because they can provide a two-dimensional image of a three-dimensional structure. So nowadays they are overcome by the using CBCT or cone beam computed tomography. At the end of this video, I am ready for an explanation about this lecture. Thank you and good luck.